Steve Levy back in our NHL studios again. San Jose shocks Detroit, shocks the world, knocking out the Detroit Red Wings tonight. There is something else going on. They are now early on in the third period. Calgary leading Vancouver in that game 7-3-2. The Canucks are now on the power play. Bonus coverage from CBC Don Whitman and Jim Poplinski.
Vancouver wins. They will fly out tomorrow to Dallas to open the series against the Stars on Monday. So we know that much as the result of the San Jose victory tonight over the Detroit Red Wings. A great chance now for Vancouver. They hold a 5-on-3 advantage, trailing by a goal. 1:20 remaining in the two-man advantage. Brown drives it in. Vernon will leave it back to the net for Patrick. Patrick is able to clear as he put it up high on the glass.
I don't mean to be critical, but 5-on-3, you cannot dump the puck in on your power play. You got to have the wheels to carry it in because you know the three guys are going to be cheating. They did that and fired it all the way down the ice.
Guy with the wheels has the puck. Burre pushes it in along the boards to Linden. Linden couldn't do anything with it. Fleury spots an opening. He was very cool, taking his time and picking his spot to shoot at the length of the ice.
If you think that's easy to do, think again. You're in the seventh game. To have the presence of mind to do that tells you the composure that you need.
Burre has it for Brown. Brown over to Lume. Lume up front for Courtnell as it was centered and Vernon made the save. Courtnell took a perfect feed from Trevor Linden. Now it's Lume with Burre in front of the net, letting the shot go, and Burre failed to redirect it. Lume will try again. He moves in over to Brown. Brown back to Lume. Lume can't shoot it. Back to Brown. He faked the shot. Moves in. Now decides to go back to Lume to Linden in front of the net. And a diving save is made by Vernon with 29 seconds remaining in the penalty to tee-off.
Well, Vancouver with good movement, but didn't generate a whole lot of scoring chances. One huge save by Vernon. The other shot was wide. Good puck movement. The three guys have to give away something, and the five guys are looking to find a hole and decide what opportunity they should take. Linden tried to go right across. Vernon got his hand on that attempted pass to Courtnell.
Save made by Vernon just as the penalty to Yanni had expired. 5-on-3 has been difficult for both sides. In the first six games of the series.
Well, power plays in general, when you look at it, oh boy, you gotta wonder what each team's been doing incorrectly because they haven't had hardly any success on the power play.
Lume gives it to Ronning. He scored both of his goals on the power play. Fakes the shot back to Lume. Lume takes a return pass into Ronning. 3 seconds left. Ronning's shot. It's grabbed by Vernon. And the whistle goes. Referee Koharski apparently lost sight of the puck, although I'm not sure that Vernon had it in his possession.
Well, I was looking at the clock expecting 1 second to be on. That wasn't the case. The puck was buried in amongst a pile of bodies. Consideration for the Norris Trophy a number of times. If you look at Norris Trophy winners, 8 of the last 9 of them have been won by either Chelios, Bork, or Coffey. In 92, Brian Leetch won it. This year, some defensemen that might get consideration would definitely include McInnes. How about Zubov in New York? Or Scott Stevens, McInnes' old defensive partner when they played for the Kitchener Rangers in the OHL.
95 postseason games for Al McInnes, all with the Calgary Flames. And if they go on to the next round, he will surpass Jim Poplinski's Calgary Flame career playoff record of 99 games. Nemesso can't control the puck along the boards, now gets it back. Nemesso flipped it high. It was deflected away from Jelena by Muhlendijk. Ronning cut off the clearing attempt. Ronning takes the shot. The puck bounced off Vernon. Nemesso again prevents the Flames from clearing. Didick out front. It bounces away from Jelena. And now Stern knocks it ahead to Muhlendijk. Muhlendijk with walls. Muhlendijk's shot goes off a leg to the corner. 16-28. Remaining in the third period, you heard one of Trent Yawney's teammates yell at him, back in, and he replied by flipping the puck back in. Now it's Courtnell in front for Lafayette, and he was tied up by the defenseman as it came back into the zone. Now it's McLean behind the net for Merzen. Merzen for Craven. Craven moves it ahead for Lafayette. Lafayette can't get his shot away as he goes down. So does Dahl. Fleury flips it up in the glass and out. 15:49 remaining in the third.
Well, Vancouver starting to put more pressure. Tim Hunter said they needed more rubber at Mike Vernon, and they have taken his words to heart in this third period.
Vernon leaves it there. Zalapski flips it off the boards. There will be no icing as McLean is forced to make the save. Brown ahead to Bure. Bure dodges a check. Bure with a long shot. That's steered with the blocker to the corner by Mike Vernon. Titov to the other corner. Two players tangled up along the boards, Linden and Zalapski. Fleury dodges a check, gets away from Linden. Fleury comes to the line. Fleury has it knocked off his stick by Babich. Sullivan takes a bump from Babich. Patrick races in from the point. Keeps it in the Vancouver zone. Brown off the boards. Here comes Linden with Adams. Linden's shot goes wide. Adams can't get to it. Didick has to try and set up again at center ice. Didick takes a pass from Bure. Didick's shot steered to the corner by Vernon. Nemesso flips it back to the net. It's cut off by the Flames, and Wall starts back. He has Titov with him. Takes a return pass. Babich takes him in against the boards. Ronning picks up the puck. 14-19 remaining in the third. 3-2. Vancouver trailing Calgary. Bure with a shot that goes wide. Lume throws it towards the net. It was wide of the goal, and back comes Roberts. Roberts with Nieuwendyk lets the shot go. It deflects off Merzen's stick high on the glass. Roberts trying to fish it out in the corner and center. It was flipped down the ice by Lume, and this will produce an icing call as Kevin Dahl goes back to touch up for the Flames. 13:47 remains in the third.
The Stanley Cup is up for grabs, so hang on. This is the NHL at its best. Check it out.
Welcome back to our Stanley Cup playoff studios here at ESPN, along with Barry Melrose, coach of the Kings. I'm Steve Levy. The shocker tonight, top story for sure, San Jose has eliminated Detroit by winning by a 3-2 score. Bonus coverage we're giving you right now, less than 14 minutes to play, Barry, in the third, Calgary leading Vancouver 3-2. What do you see so far?
If Vancouver happens to lose this game, you'll come back and look at that 5-on-3 they had and not score. Those are key times in a game like that. You got to score in a 5-on-3 situation. So that'll be a big story tomorrow if Vancouver loses.
Flames took the lead on 2 goals in a minute 5 span that seemed to turn the whole thing around.
Well, and we talked about Fleury before. This guy's the key to Calgary. He's going to be the guy that carries them. He's done it all year. He's that type of guy. He wants a puck in those situations. Great, great player.
All right, again, under 14 to play. 3-2 Calgary leads Vancouver. Again, bonus coverage. You haven't done anything special, but we give you bonus coverage anyway. Courtesy of CBC, our friends Don Whitman and Jim Poplinski.
Coach Dave King said it almost became a self-fulfilling prophecy. They lost by a 5-0 score. Although they jumped into a 3-1 series lead, the Vancouver Canucks came back with 2 overtime wins to force this 7th game. But now the Canucks trail by 3-2. 13:29, the time left in the third period. Hunter bumps with McCarthy, then steps into Dahl. Merzen gets it. Over to Lune. Toski tried to put it in front for Lafayette, but he was tied up. And Toski Krejci in the corner for Lafayette. He and Kissio are fighting to get control of the puck. It comes out front, picked up by Gall. He gets it over to Kesmer. Kesmer shoots it in and then goes to the bench. Quick shifts now. The order in the third period as time moves towards the midway point of the frame.
Well, because conditioning is a factor as well, Don, your body recovers quicker if you get out there and have 30 or 45 second shifts. You got more left towards the end of the third. The other thing that it does is it can pick up the tempo of the game, and that's what the Canucks have to do. Calgary is smothering them right now. Vancouver needs a little bit of jump, and you can get that with shorter shifts. Get two or three lines into the game, and as Tim Hunter said once again, get more rubber at Mike Vernon.
Brown drove it in. McInnes couldn't knock it out initially. Now Hennekin lets the shot go. Wide of the net, it rolls right into the crease. And Vernon had to quickly move to grab the puck as it came off the end boards with 12:09 remaining in the third. The Flames leading by one.
And welcome back, everyone. Again, the top story, San Jose knocks off Detroit tonight. The shocker, they win the series in seven games. They win by a score of 3-2. Here's Gaetan Duchesne, one of the standouts and one of the better speakers on the San Jose Sharks.
Oh, it's just unbelievable. I mean, in the room, it looks like we won the Stanley Cup. It's just unbelievable. You look at our lineup, you know, we got half of the guys who never played in the playoff before, and you got the other half who play. It's, you know, I think our team is showing a lot of character, from the young guys to the veteran.
Gaetan Duchesne, the San Jose Sharks are going to the Western Conference semifinals. Calgary leads Vancouver 3-2, 12 minutes to play out in Calgary at the Saddle Dome. Our friends at the CBC taking care of us. Don Whitman and Jim Poplinski, bonus coverage for you on ESPN.
Brodeur, Roy, and of course McLean and Vernon.
There has been some unbelievable goaltending this year, and the record of 12 shutouts seems certain to be broken the way the first round has gone. Linden and Zalapski go back of the net. They get tangled up. Burre comes crashing in, but Zalapski manages to maintain his balance. He moves the puck ahead to Patrick, who takes a hit from Linden. This is when Linden is most effective, when he's playing a physical game. Adam snaps the shot. It's blocked before it gets to the goal. Linden gets it, tried to cut in front, it's loose. Picked up by Fleury. Fleury dodges Linden as he works his way into Vancouver territory. Now he simply decides to dump it to the corner as he goes to the bench in the change. Linden starts back for Vancouver. Linden fanned on his attempted shoot-in. Yanni and Nieuwendijk almost miscued. Yanni was able to get back and pick it up, and he had to fire at the length of the ice. Icing is waved off. Here comes Ronning on the wing for Didek. Didek flips it to the corner, tries to get past Yanni, but Vernon got to the puck to clear it. 10:43 remaining in the third period. 2-1 Vancouver after one. 3-2 Calgary after two, and that's the score. Babich watched by Nieuwendijk. Now Ronning comes in with Jelena. Over to Mimesso. Mimesso for Jelena, and he failed to redirect. Mimesso bobbled it just momentarily. Here's Stern. Stern, a backhand shot. It bounced through the legs of West Wall. Reichel managed to keep it in. Then he takes up the chase of Didek as he banks it off the boards and out. We're at the midpoint of the period. Gary Roberts trying to shoot it in. It bounced off a player. Merzen goes to the corner. Kissio is after him. It comes up along the boards for Cortnell, the overtime hero in game five. Cortnell bobbled it. Waits for his mates to catch up. Still has it. Cortnell takes the shot. The rebound. They bang away. Another shot by Craven. And Vernon may have got a piece of that. Back comes Reichel. Reichel taken off the puck by Lume. Kissio picks it up. Throws it rink wide. Nobody there. Lume gathers it in. Cortnell couldn't handle the pass. And this will be icing as James Patrick goes back to touch up. 9:17 remaining in the third. 3-2 Calgary leads.
Here we go, keeping you up to the second. Again, the Sharks and the story of the night knock out the Red Wings in seven games. Right now, there's 9 minutes left in Calgary with the Flames trying to hang on to a one-goal lead, 3-2 over Vancouver.
Vancouver's getting lots of chances. They're getting good chances, scoring chances. It's going to be interesting. This is what hockey's all about. It's the best part of the game, the getting to sudden death, and when one goal means everything.
So boy, these game sevens aren't too bad.
No, they're good for the heart.
We've had four in the last two nights. Again, the CBC taking care of us. Bonus coverage for you. Don Whitman and Jim Poplinski back out to the Saddle Dome.
Good job in standing up, Cortnell, but they don't quite finish it, and all of a sudden, Cortnell keeps skating, and this scoring chance originates. Watch Kissio on the left side of your screen as he makes that sliding block.
Zalapski's point shot knocked down. It's in the skates of Titov, knocked away from him. Here comes Linden with Adams, and Adams was a little over-anxious and went in across the line ahead of Linden.
Well, travel agents have had a difficult time in keeping track of all these matchups, but with Detroit losing the game tonight, we can put it all on one page. If Calgary wins, it'll be Calgary at San Jose, and Toronto playing Dallas. If Vancouver wins, the Canucks will play the former Minnesota North Stars, now Dallas Stars, and Toronto will do a 2-3-2 series, and those would be on Monday.
9:04 remaining here at the Saddle Dome. All three games in Vancouver in this series were sellouts. Tonight's game is the first of the four in Calgary that has been a total sellout. Attendance from the 17,764 in game one has increased by about 1,000 per game.
Well, it increased substantially in Vancouver, where as soon as the Canucks came in here and dominated 5-0, there wasn't a ticket to be had.
Constantine and the San Jose Sharks sitting in Detroit watching and wondering whether they go to Toronto, whether they go to Calgary.
Murray a little bit sore right now as Constantine and the Sharks wonder, as much as they can be wondering, they also have got to be a little bit surprised that they beat Detroit. I know you got to believe, but oh boy, when you think of the difference in the two teams, system played to perfection by San Jose, and that gave them the win.
After a 0-8-1 start, the San Jose Sharks were one of the better teams in the National Hockey League, and they certainly finished with a flourish, and that momentum carried on into the postseason. Hennigan flipped it to the corner. Linden races in after it, checked by Zalapski. Sullivan has the puck. And now Hedekin will have to retreat. 8:10 is the time remaining in the third, and it's 3-2 Calgary.
Well, don't jump to your National Hockey League guide. Sit in the chair and tell me if you can remember when Vancouver won the Stanley Cup. Of course, Calgary in 1989 after a tremendous series against the Canucks. But at the start of 1915, there was an agreement between the NHA and the PCHA to have respective champions meet each year to determine a Stanley Cup champion. Now, the Vancouver Millionaires ended up playing the Ottawa Senators, and Fred Cyclone Taylor, as he was affectionately known in Vancouver for years, notched 6 goals in 3 games to lead the Millionaires to a sweep in the best of five series. So Vancouver fans looking to continue on here, but they do have a Stanley Cup to their credit, something that isn't mentioned very often.
And I wonder then if they thought there would be millionaires in the National Hockey League playing the game.
Boy, and there wasn't a millionaire with the Canucks until Kirk McLean, and that was a year or so ago.
Babich for Diddick. Vernon steers it to the corner. Meso trying to tie his man up. Freed, it comes out front. Jelena couldn't get a shot away. Babich bumps with Stern. Now Meso goes after McInnes, who forces the Calgary defenseman back. Musso picks up the puck, fires it in. 7:17 remaining in the third.
Now, as much as the Canucks are down by a goal and they only have 20 shots, this type of conversation will be going down the bench. Guys, If you would have told us at the start of this series that we'd be one goal back in the seventh game, we would have taken it. So let's find a way to get another step in our game and tie this hockey game and work towards three consecutive overtime victories.
Gary Roberts bumps into Lume, and they both go down behind the net. Courtnell flips it in, and Vernon, very active in this game and handling the puck. Reichel for Roberts, he chops it out. Merzen has to wait for Craven to come out.
Well, with the new rule where you can fire it in, that's been in effect for a few years now. Vancouver has got to get that puck right back in on Calgary. Calgary will continue to dump it out. Vancouver can have a man in and still fire it in and allow him to regroup, get out and back inside and attack with some more speed. They have to get some momentum, and Calgary's doing a strong job of taking that away by continually dumping it out and down into the end they're in right now.
O'Sullivan is the man that was assigned the shadowing job on Bure, but other people have also done a pretty effective job on him when Sullivan hasn't been on the ice. Theron Fleury and Zoli Zalapski are out there along with Sullivan right now. Dave King likes to match lines, and that could be one of the reasons that they got into difficulty with too many men on the ice on occasion. Two of those calls in Vancouver when he didn't have last change and had to get a matchup he wanted on the fly.
But King has not changed his style at all. Calgary has not done anything different in preparation for this game or in the execution of it other than play with more intensity.
Did it from taking the pass from Ronning from behind the net, flipped it up high. 5:07 is the time remaining. Icing is the call against Calgary. 3-2, the Flames lead.
Welcome back, Steve Levy, Barry Melrose. San Jose has already eliminated Detroit. Calgary trying to do the same thing to Vancouver. Now it's starting to get late for the Canucks.
Yeah, and Vancouver had a few chances early in that period, a couple of flurries, but since then, Calgary has really clamped down. They're not giving up any outnumbered chances. They're really sinking down, protecting the front of the net and keeping everything to the outside, so they've done a lot better job the last few minutes.
All right, the fine folks at Baseball Tonight, Chris Myers, Jim Kopp, they are standing by. You'll see them shortly, Baseball Tonight. You will see hockey tomorrow afternoon on ABC, the game one of the Eastern Conference semifinal series from the Meadowlands in New Jersey, the Bruins and the Devils, 1 o'clock Eastern and Pacific, noon in the Central. And then tomorrow night, across the river at the Garden in New York, the Rangers and Capitals, game one of that Eastern Conference semifinal series. Still trying to sort out the Western Conference semifinal series. Back on the CBC, Don Whitman, Jim Paplinski. This is bonus coverage on ESPN.
In the second period, Vancouver generated some jump on their 5-on-3, but didn't get as much rubber at the net as they wanted. Calgary has done a pretty good job in smothering the Canucks. They need to create some open ice, get that puck in, and see if Calgary gets them a chance to.
Walls forechecks. Keeps the puck in the zone. Uhlendijk trying to move out front. He's got Lafayette all over him. Two centers trying to tie each other up in the corner. Walls trying to free it against Babich.
You want to take that time along the boards if you're a Flame and move it as much as you can to kill the clock. If you're a Canuck, you've got to find a way to rip it loose as quickly as possible. Well, the home team has definitely had the advantage when it comes to game number 7. Since this format was introduced in 87, there's been 19 series that have required the 7 games. The home team has won game 7 a little bit better than 75% of the time. Vancouver is one goal behind from tying this hockey game and seeing if they can change that statistic. 15 of 20 as opposed to 16 of 20.
Craven had some problems handling it initially. Tried to flip it ahead to Didick, and the Calgary Flames quite content now to drive it right back in.
Well, the key is from Calgary's point of view is if they put some pressure on Vancouver or do they sit back and let the Canucks come out.
Kept in at the point by Diddick, but the Flames get a second opportunity and they clear.
Those are the little battles, Don, that we talked about at the start of the game on either side of the blue line. Well, in 1989, Mike Vernon was key in the Vancouver series and in three other series. Tony Tanney with a real rocket that was labeled for the top right, and then shortly thereafter, Stan Smeal with a perfect shot. Only Vernon was a little bit more perfect.
And then describe the winning goal, Jim.
Well, I'll tell you, if you want to know what relief is when a team has taken you right to the wire, boy, oh boy, you get that goal in overtime, and all you have to do is look at the faces of the guys on the ice to know the meaning of the word relief.
Lume continues to work in deep. Zalapski trying to stay with him. Burry takes it back to the point. Here's Adams cutting for the net. He scores! Greg Adams has tied it with 3:37 remaining.
Well, there's a pretty good chance that the footage we just saw will be required again to settle this game. Adams, who missed a couple of games with an injury after taking a shot from Burry, drives to the net, and as we said in the games that he has played, this guy is a lot stronger than he looks. Drive to the net, you never know what can happen. Adams gets position and hardly takes a shot, but somehow the puck finds its way in. And Vancouver now is going through the same thought process in their mind. If you said it would be tied with 3:37 remaining, we would have taken it. Now let's see if we can find an edge. And all of a sudden, not unlike a coin toss at the start of this game, the odds become that much closer. And we've got ourselves a wagon race here at the Saddledome.
Are we headed for a third straight overtime game? Here comes Yanni. Yanni falls. Babich picks up the loose puck. Babich moves it ahead to Mimesso. Two on one with Diddick. A drop pass for Ronning. Ronning moving in. Couldn't get the shot away. Kevin Dahl with a great play to prevent Ronning from shooting.
Boy, anybody who was upset when Dahl missed the fielder after Calgary left it at the blue line and Vancouver scored on Portnoy's great shot, better remember that play. What a huge play by Dahl. Three on one. You get joking in practice when there's a three on one and you leave the defenseman back and you're not too concerned because it doesn't affect the outcome of a game. Guys regularly yell, spread out! Well, Kevin Dahl found a way to spread out here. And Ronning just barely was stripped of the puck. Dahl, who was originally on the two on one, three on one, it changed a couple of times. Diddick with a great play to take Dahl out of it and not take a penalty, but Dahl found a way to use every inch of his stick. And James Gattinger, Flames physiotherapist, talks with Dahl. Dahl has probably stretched a muscle because he used every inch of the tendons, muscles, and stick that he was holding on to take the puck away from Cliff Ronning.
Kevin Dahl doesn't have the point, a point in the series, but he may have made the biggest play of this series. Not only did the Regina native make one save, he actually made two saves in sprawling.
Boy, oh boy, that's the kind of play that gets your heart stopped, whether you're wearing a black sweater or a white one.
2:25 remaining. Lume has to retreat to get the puck. Craven can't go anywhere with it. Ian Stern got tangled up. McInnes for Musil. Musil flipped it high over the glass and out of play with 2:08 remaining in the third, and the game tied at three.
Well, Vancouver, not unlike the San Jose Sharks, have played their game plan perfectly. You couldn't write a better script if you started it from the start for Vancouver. I'm not sure that Calgary would say the same thing. Talking with Doug Risebrough before the game, he said, you know, I wasn't real happy with the outcomes of game five and six, but I think we got a little bit overconfident after not playing as well as we might have thought and winning games three and four, and that showed up in games five and six with effort, but not with results. Calgary has played a better game here in game number seven, but Vancouver has found the edge that we talked about in the first game of this series. And now it's tied, and it gets more and more exciting as the seconds tick off in regulation time.
Well, Greg Adams has certainly altered the plans of those who may have been thinking about last rites for the Vancouver Canucks. As Greg Adams flips it ahead, Linden races after it. Fleury shoots it back in. 1:35 remaining. The last two games have gone to overtime. Hortnell winning it here at the Saddle Dome in game five. Trevor Linden late in game six, giving the Canucks victory, forcing the seventh game. Drop pass, McKinnon with a shot. McLean got a piece of it. Nieuwendyk in the corner. Back to the point, McInnes with a rocket. That hit Nieuwendyk, and Nieuwendyk did a good job keeping it onside. Walls up front for Roberts. He's knocked down. Into the final minute, Cortnell goes rink wide. Lafayette lets the shot go off McInnes. Yanni chops it along the boards. Roberts is checked. Reichel frees the puck for Fleury. Fleury trying to move in, and McLean steered it away. Fleury flipped it towards the net. Knocked to the corner. And now the Canucks back in their heels just a bit as Reichel comes in. His rink-wide pass for Fleury. Knocked back into Calgary territory. 24 seconds remaining. Merzen flips it down the ice. Zalapski is back. Zalapski checked by Mamesso, but Mamesso was tripped and couldn't go anywhere. Fleury watched by Ronnie. For Reichel, 8 seconds left. Reichel fires it to the corner, and this game is headed for overtime, folks. The third time, the third consecutive game, the extra time has been required, and it's similar to 1989.
You're looking nervous, Whit. You got
it. Welcome back, everyone. Steve Levy along with Kings coach Barry Melrose as we get set for our first overtime. Vancouver and Calgary after regulation. They are tied at 3 in the deciding game number 7. We will get you back for the start of that first overtime. But in the interim, we'll send you the baseball tonight, folks. Chris Myers and Jim Cott have been very patient. Their turn is next. This is ESPN. Everyone, sort of a traffic jam here at ESPN. Yes, Barry Melrose, Steve Levy handling the hockey for you. We'll take you out to the overtime very shortly. Vancouver and Calgary getting set for the first overtime. They are tied at 3. In case you missed it, the top story in hockey tonight, San Jose knocking out Detroit by a score of 3-2. They win the series in 7 games, 4-3. Just moments after a great Chris Osgood save, Jamie Baker scores with 13 and a half left. And San Jose goes on to defeat Detroit. The Sharks, Barry, are advancing.
Yeah, I think the owner of the Sharks is going to have to go out and get all these guys American Express cards so they all know who they are. I don't think the United States knows who these guys are.
Well, simply amazing. All right, we're getting set for the overtime again. Vancouver and Calgary, they are tied at 3, getting set for the first overtime. And here's the show. You just take a look ahead, depending upon who wins. And here's the breakdown. If Calgary wins, the Flames would play the Sharks. If Vancouver wins, San Jose would play Toronto, and that would start off on Monday. What is interesting about that, San Jose did not lose to the Leafs this year. 2 wins and 2 ties. SportsCenter comes your way at 11 o'clock Eastern Time. Back for the overtime, CBC, our friends Don Whitman and Jim Poplinski. Bonus coverage on ESPN.
Regardless of the outcome tonight at the Saddle Dome, these two teams have waged a tremendous series, and neither side will have to hang their head. There's been some great hockey, and either team will be a most worthy winner of this series to move on to the next round.
As Ron said at the start of this telecast, a huge amount of pressure, and the loser is going to face a tremendous amount of scrutiny and criticism.
National Hockey League history of the 75 series that have played and have gone to 7 games, 19 have required overtime to determine a winner. The home side has a record of 13 wins and 6 losses. In 1989, of course, familiar with Joel Otto's goal and the 4-3 victory over Vancouver. In 1991, Esa Tikkanen was the overtime hero in the Battle of Alberta.
Do you remember? remember winning the first game of the Stanley Cup Finals against Montreal in 1986 and hearing the statistic that the team that wins the first game wins 85% of the Stanley Cups. Well, we lost that year, and I started to lose my faith in some of those statistics.
Here comes Didick, trying to work past Kesmer. He takes him out of the play. McInnes will try and clear. Babbage keeps it in, a long shot, and a deflection in front of the net by Gerald Didick, and Vernon got a piece of that one. Craven trying to move out front. The puck is loose at the side of the net. Roberts goes to the corner after it. Oh, my, the Vancouver Canucks almost won this one in the opening minute.
Well, Jerry Didick has played a very, very strong series and an exceptional game tonight. If you were to pick the best three or four guys on the ice, Didick would definitely require consideration as one of the Molson Canadian three stars.
Yanni cut off a clearing attempt. Now Hedekin picks up a head of steam, tried to flip it to Ronning at center ice. It was beyond his reach, and this is an icing call against Vancouver.
Well, we talked about simple things like eliminating icings if at all possible. Calgary with a faceoff to the left of McLean now. Simple things like getting the puck at the net and jamming the net. Gerald Didick, who has been up ice a lot tonight and hasn't compromised his defensive play. Look at that deflection as he gets away from Kesmer. And Mike Vernon with a huge save. You can see he's sprawled out with an eagle eye on the puck. Didick with the first great scoring chance in overtime.
Dyke and Linden move into the face-off circle. Neuendijk gets the draw back to Musil. Musil flipped it into the corner. It was blocked there by Jelena. Jelena can't get out. Linden at the line trying to help force the puck up. They do, and then it's fired right back in. Brown chops it to the boards. Yanni pinched in against Hennekin, but the puck was knocked out to center. Intended for Neuendijk, cut off by Ronning. He comes in with Jelena. Ronning shoots, it's up high and off the glass. Lume goes back after. Over to Mirza. He dumps it to the corner. Meso tied up by Yanni as he tried to work through. Adams can't keep it in. Checking very close in the neutral zone. Now Reichel forces Mirza. Mirzin moves it ahead to Adams. He plays it in off the glove of Musil. Burre can't get to the puck. He was being watched by Sullivan.
Every time you see a team trying to make a play at the blue line or throwing the puck across and having it intercepted, all kinds of expletives are coming from that particular team's coach's mouth.
Burre gets control for Linden, a shot, and Vernon makes the save from a sharp angle. Back come the Flames, led by Sullivan. Tietoff to the net. Long shot. McLean leaves it there for Lume. Sullivan intercepts, puts it back in. Going after it is Mirzin. The speedy Sullivan on top of him. A Captain Linden comes back to help out. He can't clear. Linden knocks down a shoot-in, and this time Mirzin is able to get it out, but it's fired over the glass and out of play by Zarly Zalapski. Following tonight.
And welcome back, everyone. As the overtime continues in Calgary, we'll get you back there in just a second. Want to tell you, though, that SportsCenter comes up immediately following hockey. You will not miss a minute. The hour-long SportsCenter coming up with Gary Miller and Carl Ravitch. Hockey for you tomorrow afternoon. ABC is your place for game one of the Eastern Conference semifinal series between the Boston Bruins and the New Jersey Devils. 1 o'clock Eastern there. Then tomorrow night, they start up across the river. The other Eastern Conference semifinal game. Game number one between the Washington Capitals and the Rangers. Note that start time, 8 o'clock Eastern. Now back to Calgary.
Lactic acid away from your muscles is key. And if you ever wonder whether you should run the extra mile in the summer, this is the time where you sit on the bench and say, I'm glad I did.
Puck comes out front for Fleury. Babbage went crashing into the end boards in his own. He was very slow in getting up. Fleury feeds the point to McInnes. McInnes shoots. Puck knocked down by McLean with Roberts standing right there, but a rebound did not materialize. I think Babich would like to get off the ice. And now he's going to head to the bench. He went crashing heavily into the end board. Boy, Roberts races after the puck.
He lost an edge somehow, Don, and went face first into the wall.
Here's Courtnell trying to move into the slot. Checked by Fleury. Fleury starts back with Reichel and Roberts. Over to Reichel. His shot goes wide. It's back of the net. Did I see the red light flash momentarily behind the goal, Jim?
I think that might have been Fleury running into Hedekin. Boy, did he hit Hedekin. Hedekin wasn't ready for it and went flying into the boards.
Brown takes it back to the goal for Courtnell. Courtnell tried to move it ahead to Ronning. It was cut off by Musil. Nieuwendyk is having some problems picking it up. Courtnell can't get away. Ronning races after it. Jelena goes to the net. Ronning couldn't get it to him. Out front for Brown. Brown shot knocked down. A bouncing puck in front of the goal. And it's taken to the boards by Musil.
Boy, what a birthday present that would be for Jeff Brown. He took kind of a backhanded swing at the puck. I'm sure he wishes that he had the repertoire that Chris Chelios has, where he can switch from left to right or right to left very, very quickly. Babich, boy, did he hit the boards hard. Jerry Dittick just running through some things with him, making sure that he has all his senses. You go into the boards like that, and it sure wakes you up in a hurry. Now, Hedekin, another Vancouver defenseman that got pummeled here. Before he gets him, when Hedekin is not touching the puck, if that's one of the first three periods, Fleury is probably going to the penalty box with an interference penalty.
Kesmer over to McInnes. McInnes chops it in. Back after it goes Merzen. For Lume, he takes his time. Ahead to Ronning. Ronning for Jelena. Jelena tried to pick it out of the air and knock it in, but McInnes got there first. Lume keeps it in. He dodges a check. Lume takes his time and flipping it to the corner. Walls can't get it out. Kicked in by Merzen. Now Walls gets another chance. Walls gets to the line. Then he's knocked off the puck by Mimesa. And it's McLean who moves it ahead to Ronning. Ronning flips it down, and then the Vancouver Canucks make a change. Patrick ahead to Titov. Titov against Babich. Titov getting set. He shoots and fires wide. Patrick keeps it in. Cruz has it. Cruz goes back to the net, trying to cut out front. They jam away, and it comes loose at the side of the net. And now Dittick trying to get it out. Has it picked off by Sullivan? Linden, who has lost his helmet in that scrum in front of the net, remains out there as Sullivan fires it to the corner. Cruz after it. Cruz shoots. Dittick clears the rebound to the boards. Babich and Cruz have each other tied up. Reichel goes back to the net. Reichel circling to get away from Linden. Reichel out front, and McLean makes the save. With traffic in front of the net, Zalapski was driving in. Cruz was there as well.
Well, we could play the last 2 minutes over, and they'd be just as exciting. Vancouver with pressure on Calgary a little bit earlier. All of a sudden, take a look here, as Cruz goes to the net with Linden. Linden plays rolling pin as he takes Cruz along the back crossbar of the net. And then Reichel, look where he puts the brakes on here and loses his check, and then jumps out in front. Dittick is left looking for somebody coming in, and McLean has to stop Reichel as he went around. The Calgary bench jumps up as Reichel comes out in front. And you can bet these guys are making sure that they're picking the right guy. And only one is going when one comes off. And as Trevor Linden said, it could have happened to Vancouver as well. The little things. If you're not playing a lot in overtime, you're helping the coach on the bench and screaming at who the next guy up is, so that what we saw in game six doesn't happen again.
McInnes with a shot and a pad save by McLean. That one was labeled for the top corner. Reichel takes the puck to the boards. And finally, Koharski. Vasilevsky skating in, blows his whistle as four players succeed in freezing it. Al MacInnis leading all players in this series with shots, and he has been the busiest shooter in this seventh game. He had five shots on goal in regulation time, and this one almost won it in overtime.
Well, a great angle on the shot. But even if you can shoot the puck as well as Al MacInnis, most National Hockey League goalies, when MacInnis is back at the blue line, will stop the shot.
MacInnis lets it go, and McLean has got it in his pads.
Providing they can see it, MacInnis taking a little bit of time there to go to the side and hopefully get a screen on McLean. Face-offs, you mentioned icings, or face-offs in your end. Winning them, you don't want them. McLean moves right down to the side, and notice how he puts it on the net. Takes a little bit more care, perhaps taking something off the shot. If he misses the net, and Vancouver has got a winger breaking, you can have the same opportunity that Cortland got 4 days ago.
That San Jose charter airplane remains in a holding pattern. Here's MacInnis with a shot, deflected. It goes up high. Hedekin tried to hit Courtnell, who was skating down the left side, but he missed him with the pass. Gesmer's long shot right on, and Roberts was still inside the blue line. It's an offside call.
Well, that has to be blown down right away. If the puck ever bounced and went in, you would create a real uproar. So the linesman watch. The player is inside the blue line and the puck is shot at the net. The whistle is blown immediately, and that's why it comes out to the point where Jordan Brossinger sits now to have the face-off.
Gary Roberts had an interesting comment about the beating he sometimes takes in front of the net. He said, you have to worry about the puck, not the player behind it.
Well, you also have to protect yourself.
Here's Lafayette. Pushing it past MacInnis. Vernon comes out to play it. Lune keeps it in. Courtnell for Craven. Craven out front. Lafayette couldn't get a good shot away. Courtnell took a swipe at it. Craven has it again. Craven shoots. Vernon makes the save. Roberts moves it ahead to Fleury. Here he comes with Reichel. Fleury for Reichel. Great save by Kirk McLean. And Jim, I think the red light came on again.
Well, Don, I pressed the silence switch because you should have heard what I said after that save. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable excitement so far in the game in Calgary. And as you would expect, Barry Melrose, tight defensive checking all over the place in the overtime.
Well, after watching the Detroit-San Jose game and then come to this one, it's unbelievable. It's so wide open. Each team is getting tons of chances. This isn't how overtime is supposed to be played. But I don't think anybody on either team wants to try and challenge New Jersey Buffalo's record.
But we're not quick. We're not complaining, though. Exciting for the fans.
It's great.
Anyone to look for? Anyone stand out in your mind? This guy's an overtime player. Watch for him.
Fleury, Linden.
All right, there you have it. From the coach of the Kings, Barry Melrose. Again, SportsCenter comes up immediately following hockey right now. Again, our friends from the CBC, Don Whitman, Jim Poplinski, bonus coverage from Calgary on ESPN.
Great pass by Fleury. Better save by McLean.
Well, Kirk McLean had his right leg in behind the goal line, and that puck was headed for the net when he threw it out and hit it right at the line. The off-ice officials tonight are from San Jose. Maybe they're just a little excited about the Shark win in Detroit. Johnny being watched by Ronning. Walls has it. Didick prevents Nieuwendyk from clearing. Lead pass goes all the way down the ice.
A great second effort by Ron Stern just to get a stick on it before the red line. He swung around to prevent the icing.
Ronning gets away from Nieuwendyk with Mimeso. Mimeso on the wing for Jelena. It goes right to the net. And as Musil and Jelena get tangled up.
And welcome back as the overtime continues from Calgary, Vancouver, and Calgary going at it 3-3. We'll get you back for the overtime. San Jose, in case you missed it, San Jose and Detroit, and the Detroit Red Wings are knocked out. An 8 knocks out a number one, one of the biggest upsets in recent hockey memory. Interesting to note, Chris Osgood had made a brilliant save on Ulf Dahlin, and then just seconds afterwards, the game winner. Came with about 13 and a half to play. Again, after the great Osgood save, the bad clear, and Jamie Baker is the hero as the San Jose Sharks go on for the 3-2 win. And you wonder about the situation in Detroit now. I mean, what kind of shakeup? They spent some money. They've brought in a lot of people there, and it's got to be embarrassing for a number one seed to go down to San Jose.
It's very tough for the organization, but it's a great organization. They've got great players. They're deep. They don't need to make a lot of changes. They'll be back again.
Of course, it's tough to question Scotty Bowman with all that he has done.
Very much.
Again, back to overtime. 3-3, back to Calgary.
Adams tied up behind the net by Patrick. And now it's Zalapski, overskating at center ice. Burry gets back. Burry falls, but Cruz can only nudge the puck past him. Sullivan watching Burry. Burry flips it high, and Zalapski goes back. This is the matchup. These are the players that Dave King wants on the ice whenever Burry is out there. Here's Reichel, but it's offside. Pavel Bure with a goal tonight. He had a goal in game five of this series, but that was his first playoff goal in eight games. And people in Vancouver, I'm sure, were growing a little concerned, but coach Pat Quinn said he's playing and he's getting chances. The goals will come.
Well, and Adams almost gets two in a row here. That would be the last goal of the series. That big long reach. You know, Vancouver hasn't had a whole lot of shots this period, only two, but they have been all around the Calgary net and have generated some close scoring opportunities.
Cortino can't get it out. Fleury directs it to the corner. McLean comes out of his net for Cortino, and this time Cortino flips it down the ice. It bounces past McInnes. Kesmer goes back and leaves it there for McInnes. Merzen knocked down a long lead pass intended for Reichel. That may have been a huge play by the Calgary native and veteran rear guard. Reichel had a full head of steam, and McInnes spotted him. McInnes and Corton will go after the loose puck. Reichel chops it along the boards and down the ice. McLean way out of his net with Roberts in pursuit. Diddick decides to go back the other way. 9:19 remaining in overtime. Here comes Ronnie. He can't get past Yanni. Walls checked by Babich. Nieuwendyk has it. Nieuwendyk trying to drive out front. Diddick ties him up. Running for Craven. Craven, the Medicine Hat native. Flips it in, goes to the bench in a change. Musil starts back for Stern. He's bumped by Hedekin. Nieuwendyk knocks it to the corner. 8:47 remaining in this first overtime period. Patrick fires it back in. Walls trying to work his way up to the line and finally gets up. He was being hampered a bit by a Vancouver player. Patrick, through some traffic, can't move with it. It's flipped in, knocked down by Brown. For Hedekin, ahead to Linden. Linden flips it to the corner. Vernon comes out of the net to play it. Patrick has possession. Patrick to Zalapski. Rink wide for Cruz. Left there for Tito. Tito tied up as the puck goes to the corner. Linden starts back for Vancouver. 8 minutes remaining in the first overtime. Linden's long shot just wide. Boy, he got something on that one. Tito bumped by Lafayette. Cruz flips it to the corner, and again, McLean comes way out of his net to play it.
Boy, as much as the goaltenders haven't had a whole pile of tremendous scoring chances in the first three periods, both guys, in particular the McLean, have been key in extending this period.
Reichel rubbed out by Diddick behind the net. Roberts, he couldn't get a stick on it. And back comes Craven for Diddick. Didick has really had a strong series. Here's Roberts moving in. Roberts shoots, and McLean got a piece of it. Fleury has it. Fleury tried to throw it to the front of the net. It was blocked there by Lafayette, then Fleury knocks him down. Portnoy dumps it to the corner. Craven gives chase. Craven trying to get away from McInnes. He's knocked down. The puck comes back to the line. Hennick and shoots. Ronan gets the rebound, and Vernon makes another save. Oh, what action we've got in overtime with 6:43 remaining.
The only thing better than watching this is playing it if you've got the stomach for it. Gary Roberts with a big shot from the left side. Fleury once again involved in the play, and McLean challenges, catches a piece of it to put it wide. Now down at the other end, Hedekin with a big shot. Ronnie is left alone, and Fleury has come all the way back to get number seven. But Vernon had to be sharp as well, as Ronnie is very crafty when he's in close. And we're still playing.
Well, Brett Hedekin is the least likely of any player to score the overtime winner. He's gone 133 regular season and playoff games without scoring. But boy, he tested Mike Vernon as he pounced in that puck in the slot. The last goal he scored was for St. Louis, April 14th, 1992. And his only goal.
If you can get one every couple of years, Don, and play strong defensively.
Oh, a shot from the faceoff by Mimesso. Hit the post. There have been close calls at both ends. Ronning can't keep it in. Round to Hedekin. Musso. For Titoff, he can't get out. Musso will try again. Musso dumps it to the corner. Calgary making a change. Hedekin overskated it, but Ronning was there. For Jelena. Jelena trying to work around Patrick, and the veteran defenseman knocked it away from him. Zalapski moves it to Stern. Stern drives it to the corner. Zalapski races in after it. Back of the net for Stern. He's checked. Roberts centers it. Nobody there. Linden brings it back. Linden trying to split the defense, and Patrick is able to recover and pick up the puck. Lume puts it back into the corner. 5:35 remaining in this first overtime period. Game seven, with the winner moving on. Vancouver, if they win, will play Dallas. If Calgary wins, they'll be at home to San Jose on Monday. Icing is the call with 5:14 remaining in the first overtime.
Well, this chance happened very quickly, and it's the reason you try to limit the faceoffs in your end. Right off the draw, Mimesso, who's got a very heavy shot, couldn't get any closer without ending this game. Although it was not a one faceoff, halfway between, Mimesso was quick on the draw. Perfect angle on the shot. Hits the post, bang on. And there's a sigh of relief, a bit of a grin from McIntyre. You can read the lips of Sean Antoski as well.
Well, the theme song of the Eagles, A Heartache Tonight, our opening to this telecast. And boy, oh boy, there's been heartache for a couple of players in tonight's hockey game already.
Well,
this overtime session.
No question, Don. And I don't think you can underestimate the pressure either. Vancouver building in excess of $100 million. A lot of discussion here in Calgary about grants to be used to put some millions of dollars into the building. The ownership looking at putting money in. Big contracts. Both teams have lacked playoff success for the last half a dozen years at least. And when you put all those ingredients together, Vancouver with a subpar performance in the regular season, Calgary, as Ron mentioned at the start of this hockey game, has overcome a lot of obstacles. Boy, a huge heartache when it's over and somebody's had to lose.
Back to the line for Lume. Lume goes to the corner. Lume going back. back to the net, out front, a backhand shot, the puck loose, Lafayette takes a shot, and the save is made by Vernon. Do you think Lafayette, who did not play the first five games, has an assist in game six and seven, would be an excited young man being from New Westminster if he were to pot the overtime winner?
Be able to run for mayor. Lume with a good job here on McGinnis as he uses the net. McGinnis is caught out of play, and look at Lafayette. He's open in front. You could use your security blanket and cover all the flames as they converge on the Canucks. Five there, one guy out in front that's gone by Lafayette.
Babich with a shot, saved by Vernon. Fleury starts back. On the left side for Reichel. Reichel winds and fires it wide. McGinnis keeps it in. Babich goes to the corner after him. 4:48 remaining in overtime. Lead pass for Cortnell. It would have been over two lines. The executive
producer. Welcome back, everyone, as the overtime continues and we are running into the possibility of a second overtime. SportsCenter, though, will follow hockey. We'll tell you that. Got a lot of teams sitting around waiting to see what's going on in the West. The East is already settled, we know for sure. And it will start tomorrow night at the Garden in New York. The Rangers and Caps tomorrow afternoon on ABC. The Bruins and the Devils from the Meadowlands. First things first, let's look at the Caps and Rangers. Let's take a step ahead. There's been a lot of talk about the Rangers, Barry, having the week off. In preparations, that help them? Does that hurt them? It's a veteran club.
Well, it's a veteran club, so that's not a big deal to them. I think Mike will be a little worried the first period of the first game. They haven't played in a week. You got to get back to that hitting and then that mental toughness. So he'll be a little worried the first period.
All right, the overtime is back underway. 3-3 Vancouver and Calgary. Back out to Calgary.
It's up high on the glass and out. Babbage will try and bring it right back in. With Ronning. Ronning leaves it there. Jelinek's shot. Vernon has it in his pads. And you talk about defensemen jumping up in the play. Gerald Didick has been doing that most of this series, and he was really driving for the Calgary net.
Well, as we've said a couple of times, Didick has been absolutely outstanding in the series, and he has excelled to a higher level in this seventh game. That's what coaches look for. Jelinek shooting at the net, Ronning driving through, and then a little bit later, a shot from the left-hand side again. Jelinek once again, great wheels, chooses to shoot, the correct decision, and then charges the net. Watch Didick come in here, and Stern does an excellent job of taking the much bigger player into the net. But if there's a rebound, it's going to go in off the skate as opposed to Didick's stick.
4:18 remaining in this first overtime. Linden and Sullivan are in the circle. They tie each other up. Adams tried to go to the puck, but Patrick had him covered. Hedekin goes back after it. Titov chasing him. Brown was doing a good job of running interference for his defensive partner. Here comes Linden. Linden dumps it to the corner. Adams was struggling to try and stay onside. Titov takes the lead pass, can't handle it. Patrick fires it in. Burré takes it away from Sullivan. Burré moves into the slot area. Burré trying to get set for a shot. Knocked down by Zalapski. Cruz puts it down the ice and Calgary makes a change. Vancouver trying to take advantage of those changes. We've seen that about four times in this overtime where McLean comes quickly out of the net and plays it up the left wing boards.
Well, tactically, Vancouver has exercised their strategy perfectly. You know, shots on net, Calgary had a decided advantage for the first two periods, 16-8 on both counts. Vancouver outshot Calgary 6-4 in the third, and in the overtime, 8-7 in favor of the Flames. But 8-7 does not give you an indication of the number of scoring opportunities that we've witnessed in the first 16 minutes and 40 seconds of this overtime. The puck has been around both goalies on numerous occasions.
McGinnis with a shot right on. Fired wide by Reichel. Kesmer at the point. Puts it back at the net, cut off by Lume. LeMay's been a cool customer in clearing the zone at times. Now back to McInnes. It hopped away from him. Cartnell racing after it, and McInnes knocks him down. Lafayette and Fleury are tangled up. Cartnell lost his stick, and McInnes fires the puck down the ice. McLean is forced to make the stop, and as a result, no icing. Musil for Reichel. Reichel moving in on the right side. Roberts goes for the net. Centering attempt, and Roberts went crashing into the net, and McLean has the puck underneath him.
Now, Roberts was doing a great job in getting position on Murray Craven. Craven did the right thing, perhaps not the legal thing, but the right thing, as he took him down just before the puck came across. This bouncing puck, and all of a sudden everyone in this building is saying, oh, here we go again, there's Cartnell. It's a penalty any other time. McInnes took him down, and Gary Roberts driving to the net. Watch Craven here, puts the one hand on him, and when he gets close enough, he says, that's just about far enough, Mr. Roberts. He's figuring that Koharski let McInnes go with the hook on Cortnell at the red line. The least you can do is return the favor, and that's what happened as Bobby Stewart tunes up the blade of Gary Roberts. Roberts drives to the net, probably caught his skate on the post, has a bit of a burr. Stewart, the equipment manager for the Flames, tunes it up a tad.
And Roberts has removed the protective collar he was wearing.
Well, he told me that he's had a real tough time getting it to feel right. He's taken it off, and the adrenaline and the emotion right now are his painkiller.
Stern attempted to shoot it in and deflected into the Calgary bench.
Well, Ron Stern came to the Calgary Flames on a trade with the Vancouver Canucks. Dana Merzen went the other way. Stern has been a welcome addition here, and Merzen has been welcome to the Vancouver Canucks. Won the Canucks Award in 92-93 as the best defenseman. They gave him the A this year, and he picked up his game as well. In 93-94, had a couple of slow spots. This guy's only 26 years old. He's been in the league now for 8 years, started with Hartford as a first-round pick with the Whalers.
2:23 remaining in this first overtime. Back to the line for Didick, in front for Mamesso, and Mamesso was checked there by Musil. Oh, Yanni hammers Jelen in against the boards. Ronning turns in the corner. Ronning behind the net. Ronning throws it in front. Vernon wasn't sure for a moment where the puck was, and as it bounced, he pounced.
Well, Calgary has been guilty a couple of times of looking for a puck instead of the body, but you're not going to accuse Trent Yanni of that. Look at this check on Jelena. Lifts him right up and into the glass and puts him down and then gets back in the play. But Ronning, in the meantime, is left unguarded. And this puck rolls up and onto Vernon's pad. You see Jelena, who's back to his feet and fighting to get to the net. Somehow the puck has been bobbling on Mike Vernon. We've used that term a few times. There's a couple other that can describe it. I guess English on the puck is one.
Cruz skated to the blue line, flipped it down the ice, and Hedekin races back to touch up for an icing call. Cruz is a player who has improved his game over the last couple of years. He came into the Flames organization from Kamloops, didn't play much his first couple of seasons, spent time in the minors. He had to work on the defensive aspects of his game, and Dave King feels he's really improved in that area.
It's a good example of a player who can skate. If you can skate and you can listen, there's a pretty good chance that if you get to this level, you can catch on in the National Hockey League, and Cruz has done just that.
Titov trying to get around Hedekin. Titov in front, and McLean somehow got a piece of that one. Up front again, a wraparound try, and again McLean keeps it out with another scrum in front of the net. It almost looked as though Titov, as he came down, was double clutching. He shifted gears and found that extra speed to drive for the net.
Well, he does exactly that. I don't know how McLean stopped this puck. A tremendous move by Titov, and McLean is right there. Titov with a great presence of mind to go back and come at it again. Confusion as Hedekin gets caught on the other side of the net. Titov senses that and tries to jam it in. That change of pace that you talk about, Don, is so important. It doesn't matter how fast you are in this league. The defensemen are so good one-on-one that if you come down at 100 miles an hour at the same speed, they can skate backwards just as fast, and they'll ride you to the corner. You got to change your pace and the position of the puck, or you don't beat anybody one-on-one in the National Hockey League.
Well, we have seen some outstanding goaltending in the playoffs, and in this overtime session, both Mike Vernon and Kirk McLean have made brilliant saves to keep the game deadlocked at three.
Well, you look at different players. Trevor Linden is a good example of a guy who has really picked up the level of his play. I can name a half a dozen others over the last half a dozen years that have picked up the level of their play and sustained that into the next season. Linden, with a slow regular season, is playing the best hockey of his career, and now his coaches and his teammates, and most importantly, he himself, has got to realize what he's done to do that and then continue that level in the regular season and the rest of his career. That is what turns great players into superstars.
Lume being watched by Titov. Babich trying to move it along the boards, having some problems. Now Adams flips it over to Lume. Burre up by the blue line, couldn't control the pass, and Vernon plays it to the corner. Adams cuts it off. He throws it out front, but it's intercepted by Titov. And as it's flipped into the zone and touched, it's an offside call against Vancouver with 53.6 seconds remaining in this first overtime period. Well, wherever you're looking in tonight on Hockey Night in Canada, we hope you're enjoying the action. And remember, a doubleheader coming your way tomorrow. It will be the Bruins and the Devils in the afternoon, and in the evening, the Rangers and the Capitals. And then Monday night, wherever you live, we'll have action for you, depending upon which teams advance out of this series. Toronto will play either Dallas or San Jose, and the winner of this one will play the team that Toronto doesn't play. Is that clear?
Well, it makes sense to me, Don. But then I rarely listen to you.
You wanted to go into all the playoff possibility matchups for the second round when all teams were still alive.
I would have needed your abacus to calculate those percentages.
Lafayette to the corner for Courtney. Now Calgary with Fleury starting down the left side for Roberts. Fleury is spun around by Diddick. The puck is loose. Now McInnes gets it to Reichel. He shoots it in. Roberts has it. Roberts trying to move in front. He's checked there and knocked down by Hedekin. McLean used a stick to poke the puck away from Reichel as he was trying to move out front. 8 seconds remaining in this first overtime period. And folks, we have got a second overtime session coming up here at the Olympic Saddle Dome.
Welcome back to our ESPN studios, everyone. Lots of people waiting on the conclusion of this one. Barry Melrose, myself, and the San Jose Sharks, who are sitting around waiting to find out where they have to fly next. We will get you back for the start of the second overtime. Vancouver and Calgary, they are tied at three, but SportsCenter is up next with Gary Miller and Carl Ravitch. We'll see you in a little bit. Just hang aside for SportsCenter and baseball tonight. You still holding up? You all right?
Very good, very good.
You look fine. Barry Melrose, coach of the Kings.
Finisher.
Steve Levy with you as well. We're getting set for the second overtime. Vancouver and Calgary, you will not miss a minute. But here's the big shocker around the hockey world. San Jose, a 3-2 winner over Detroit. Jamie Baker got the game winner with about 13 and a half left. And the Sharks, an 8, take out a number 1. What is amazing about this, and you question the regular season, it meant much more this year, obviously, with the new playoff format, but Detroit had 103 points in the regular season last season, lost to Toronto in the first round. This year they had 100 points, and again, they're knocked out in the first round. So what does that do for you?
I think it's very important to realize that it's a team that's playing the best going into the playoffs. It doesn't help to finish with 120 points and not be playing well, because the last month doesn't mean anything to you. San Jose had to play well for last month because they had to beat us out. So they were playing good the whole last month. Every game was a playoff game. They were mentally tough as the playoffs approached. And they just marched right into the playoffs, as Gaetan Duchesne said.
All right, Dallas and Toronto are sitting home right now, still trying to figure out who they're going to play next. San Jose, for all we know, they could still be at Joe Louis watching the game. Maybe they're on the plane on the tarmac. They don't know where they're going. They're certainly not going to go home. They know they have to be on the road. They will either go to Calgary or Toronto, but they have to be in a holding pattern probably on the tarmac right now waiting. Can you relate to that?
I can relate. I'll tell you how the mindset works here. I can guarantee you that San Jose coaches are holed up someplace with a TV. They're watching the game, seeing who they're going to play, devising strategy. But the players are in the room or wherever telling each other how great they are and how great a team they have. The players don't really care who they play. It's up to the coaches to get them ready.
All right, we're getting set for that second overtime, 3-3. The CBC, we thank them. Don Whitman, Jim Poplinski, bonus coverage on ESPN.
Back after it goes Brown. Brown was a double overtime hero in game two last year. St. Louis beating the Toronto Maple Leafs by a score of 2-1. The shoot in is bobbled. The puck is loose, and it's deflected to the corner. Adams moves out with Brown. Long shot, a bit of a knuckler. Got up on edge, and as Don Cherry said during the intermission, the goaltenders aren't about to take any chances. If someone is coming to the net, they are going to smother the puck.
Well, Grapes, I thought, made a couple of great points after the first period of overtime. And one of those was that you have to use your bench as we get a look at this knuckleball. Remember, the referee tends to put his whistle away in overtime, so you don't have near the amount of time to rest everybody. There's not as many stoppages of play typically, so you need more guys going. King and Pat Quinn will definitely be using three lines and spotting a fourth, and as the game wears on, they'll be happy that they did.
Fleury races after the puck, knocked back in by Diddick. Fleury redirects the pass from Al MacInnis down the ice. Al MacInnis gets it again. Fleury can't handle it. Fired in by Lafayette. You know, he was almost the forgotten man in that St. Louis trade. But after failing to dress for the first five games of this playoff round, he has performed very well for Vancouver.
Well, we've got 80 minutes expired, a minute and 7 seconds in this period. Let's take a look at how much ice time some of the guys have played. Murray, Linden, Neuendijk, and MacInnis. Look at MacInnis, almost at 40 minutes. In game six, Murray played 34-40, surpassed that total in game six versus what he's done tonight. Linden was just over 30 minutes. MacInnis was 32-51, and Neuendijk was 22-22. So comparable ice times from game six to game seven, a little bit more ice time to have been played here due to a full overtime period having been extinguished.
Ronning will go up against Fleury, the two smallest men on the ice tonight. The draw comes back to Hedekin. Hedekin over to Lume, a backhand shot that deflects off a leg to the other corner. Mimesso has it. Mimesso takes a shot from a sharp angle, and it was held by Vernon with Jelena driving in on top of him.
Mimesso with a sharp angle shot, and once again, as the coach said after the first OT period, shoot everything at the net. If it forces a face-off, great. That's what you want. If you're 50-50 on draws, you got a great opportunity to get another one at the net.
Castillo doesn't take any chances. He flips it down the ice. Stern and Lume battle for it. It comes around the other side. Walls gets it. He puts it back to the net. Stern trying to get control. He leaves it in the corner for Kissio. Walls goes to the net. And Lume managed to tie up his stick. Jelena dumps it in, and then the Vancouver Canucks make a complete change. Walls with a long shot that McLean handles, flips ahead to Linden. Linden to Adams. Adams is tied up as he tried to go to the corner after it. Cruz has it now. He takes a hit along the boards from Linden. Brown, a hit for Murray. Murray going in. He scores! Cavell Murray has won it for the Vancouver.
Well, that has silenced all but the crowd that came in from Vancouver for this game, and there will be smiles ear to ear. What a huge goal for Vancouver. We talked about the pressure on this hockey team and on the Calgary Flames. Well, Burry found a way to break loose. And this hockey game is over. The series is over. Vancouver will be playing Dallas. Toronto will be playing San Jose. What a huge goal by Burry. This is one that Vancouver fans will remember just as long as Flame fans remember Joel Otto's goal in 1989.
Pavel Burre, who had been held in check through the first four games of the series, finally got on the board in game five. Pat Quinn, the coach and general manager, said he never lost confidence in his star performer. He continued to give him plenty of ice time, and Burre tonight has two goals and an assist, the most important one, of course, the overtime winner that sends the Vancouver Canucks off to Dallas to take on the Stars in the semifinal of the Western Conference, setting up a Toronto-San Jose battle.
And welcome back, everyone. Pavel Burre, who was criticized for not scoring early on in this series, comes up with a big goal to give Vancouver the win in double overtime. The Canucks become the 12th team in NHL history to come back from a 3-1 deficit. They advance on. Barry Melrose talked about it earlier. Home ice advantage in a game seven. You saw it. Didn't see it at all tonight. The road team wins both of them. San Jose wins 3-2 over Detroit in the big shocker of the first round of the hockey playoffs. So here are now your Western Conference matchups with Vancouver winning. San Jose now knows they can take off the fly for Toronto. Vancouver will play in Dallas Monday night. You'll see that game from Reunion Arena here on ESPN. Here's the schedule for tomorrow, which on the East Coast is officially now this afternoon. ABC, 1 o'clock Eastern and Pacific, noontime in the Central Time Zone. You'll see game one between Boston and New Jersey. Then tomorrow night on ESPN2, don't be fooled because it's ESPN2, it's only game one. Game one on ESPN2 of the Eastern Conference semifinal series. The Washington Capitals and the New York Rangers, note the start time there is 8 o'clock Eastern Time. Barry Melrose, thanks for hanging in.
Good night. We'll
Good
see
morning.
You. We'll see
Good
you again
afternoon.
Soon. Sports Center is coming up next. Again, Gary Miller, Carl Ravitch standing by. I'm Steve Levy for all of us here. Thanks for watching. Have a good night. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.